Well, good morning, everyone. Thank you so much for being here today. We have some technical difficulties there, but we're on the move and we're starting now. And we may have some more support coming shortly there. But I wanted to begin because I know your time is precious, our panelists' time is precious, and it's a great topic for us to be exploring this morning. So thank you for being here. My name is Sean Parr. I'm a professor in the Fine Arts Department. I teach music here at the college. And I'm grateful to be the Bready Chair this year, which has allowed me to develop my research and to organize a panel such as this for the college community, which I think is very important in this day and age. And I think that I also want to be sure to thank the Center for Ethics and Society, who is co-sponsoring this event, for their support as well. And so hello to everyone on Zoom, and hello to everyone here this morning. I'm going to give brief introductions to our panelists. I believe they will further introduce themselves as the panel continues. First, we have Angie Lane, who is the executive director of the Red River Theaters in Concord. Then we have Desirée Garcia, professor at Dartmouth College, an expert on the musical film. Her third book is coming out soon on these topics there, and we're looking forward to hearing her thoughts. We have James McKim, president of the Manchester NAACP and also a musician. We have Matthew Morrison, professor of music at the Tisch School for the Arts at NYU. His book is also coming out very soon on Black Sound. We have Jesse Saywell, professor of theater here at St. A's. He's our new Abbey Players director this year, and he is an accomplished actor, director, and playwright himself. Jaime Orego, next, professor of Spanish in our modern languages department. He has written a lot about violence in Colombia, but also is a creative writer and writes fiction as well. Laura Shea, at the end there, is a professor in fine arts as well. She is an art historian, history of photography, and she will be providing some interesting controversies from recent years in the art world. All right, so that's a quick introduction to everyone there. I want to dive right in because I know we want to get to the substance. So I'd like to begin with a loose claim, loosely attributed to Friedrich Nietzsche. If you crush a cockroach, you're a hero. If you crush a beautiful butterfly, you're a villain. Morals have aesthetic criteria. Now, that's a vivid image, right? This aphorism striking because of that vividness, but it's also really direct. And it's relevant today in the sense of who is the cockroach, who is the butterfly, who gets to decide, and why? And why should that matter? So it's clear that today we're beginning from the assumption that the relationship between ethics and the arts has always fascinated thinkers. If we assert that ethics concerns moral principles that govern a person's behavior or the conducting of an activity, then there are many ways that the arts provoke us to confront ethical challenges, sometimes in startling ways, from direct connections between the messages conveyed by stage works, vocal music, and socially conscious art exhibitions, to the suggested ethical dimensions of art that challenge our perceptions and prompt debate. So today in this symposium, panelists will take the discussion of arts and ethics a step further to consider how race can and should inform ethics and the arts. There are at least two ways of considering the intersections of race and the arts that are fundamental to our discussion today. First, representation of race in artistic content. Asking questions such as, what is art telling us? Who is the intended audience? What are the intended messages and effects? What does this artistic construction of beauty tell us about a historical era and its construction of race? And second, representing race in the identity of the artistic creator, asking questions about who's the author and what's their identity? Who are the presenters or performers of the art? Who is missing from these presentations and why? And so to put some of this a little bit more bluntly, we still need to reckon with the question, what do we do with great art by bad people? With these questions in mind, we can begin to consider art that confronts racism and contests inequitable systems. We'll work through the idea that art is thus capable of doing ethical work, illuminating and challenging racial justice issues. And now we can begin with our first set of three questions. We have three sets of questions, excuse me. On the power of art, how can art trouble us? How can art confront racism? And how does our identity inform our choices and understanding of art's power and ethical dimensions. And so just to give you a sense of the format today, we have these three sets of questions. Each panelist has contributed either a visual image or a video clip to help us kind of give some specificity to talking about these issues and answering some questions and discussing. So we'll be proceeding through these questions there, and along the way you'll see each panelist have a moment of focus on these questions there. And we're going to begin with Angie Lane. Thank you so much.
I like it. It helps with the nerves because you give me something to do with my hands. So a little about me. I'm the executive director of Red River Theaters. I've been in the position for 7 years, and I grew up here in New Hampshire, as you know, is predominantly a white population. I was adopted, so I grew up with a white family, and ultimately, for me, media and art was a way to help kind of form my identity, which is kind of scary. So in being on this panel, I was really thinking about specifically in my identity, looking at things I grew up with. And these are I was a weird kid. I watched a lot of musicals and absorbed my Asian identity through these characters. And it's troubling too, as you can see, some of these are portrayed by white actors. And as a kid, I felt uncomfortable. I just didn't have the words. And my parents are very lovely people, Anne and Richard Lane. But they didn't necessarily have the tools to help with my own racial identity. So just talking about how art can trouble us, I mean, in our guts, as a child, I was uncomfortable with a lot of these portrayals. Sometimes I laughed along or identified with them. You know, as an Asian American, it was really, I could be a nerd. I was definitely not feeling cool ever. there was just a very small, block for me to, or a space for me to occupy, and I took media as a way to help build who I was in my personal identity. And when we're talking about confronting racism, I mean, when we look at these now, I think, you know, even when I watched Breakfast at Tiffany's, I didn't know that Mickey Rooney was not an Asian person, but even as a child, I was uncomfortable with that. But no one could explain that to me, and frankly, I laughed along too because everybody was laughing. So, you know, looking at these kind of portrayals and being able to unpack them now, you know, we can say and sit back and say, oh, well, we understand these to be, you know, racist portrayals or inappropriate casting, racist casting. Back then, I mean, and even today, as a leader of a movie theater, a lot of folks will say to me, well, you should show this, it's a classic. You know, I'm uncomfortable with that because I think that it requires context and the responsibility as someone who runs a cinema, and I have the power to control some of our programming, not all of it. It's really, you know, it sits with me, and I think about that a lot in my personal identity and what my responsibility is and how we can confront this sort of racism that still, quite frankly, exists. The people who are making films or the people that are getting the spotlight, those folks are still mainly white, cis, gender. You know, we are still in troubled times. I think it is important that we, you know, as art can confront these in the way that we portray characters and being responsible. And the first thing I thought about was Hamilton and what a revelation that was. For children growing up and to be able to, it's almost different, right? Instead of casting a white person in an Asian role, you're portraying these historic characters with this different racial identity and what that means. So, you know, when thinking about this particular question, it's and looking at my personal point of view, you know, looking at how art and particularly film, you know, the responsibility of making sure the programming, if there is something within this film, like having context, having the conversation, and really asking more of our audiences to confront and unpack, because I certainly was a passive consumer, and I still am probably in a lot of ways. Like, I, you know, but looking at things and trying to unpack it yourselves as an audience member to question it. Why was this actor cast? And what is, you know, why wasn't, you know, if this character is supposed to be, you know, black, why is a white actor playing this character? So, but I think art is powerful, and film in particular is an opportunity to kind, you know, if you stand up in front of people and tell them data and tell them all of the scientific, you know, back it up and tell it, that doesn't necessarily get through, but art is different. It can hit your heart and your soul, and you know, it can change the way you feel about yourself. And as a young Asian woman growing up in New Hampshire, I tell the story a lot, but it was the first time I saw, it was Wayne's World, it was Tia Carrere, and it was this, and she was cool, she played in a band. And it truly was the first step where I was like, oh, Asian people can be cool. And so here I am at 44 years old, and I'm still unpacking that and confronting that. And still, even now, I get teary-eyed when I see programming like Never Have I Ever, or, you know, Crazy Rich Asians, and all these, you know, roles that might have BIPOC actors, but there's no specific reason that they're, you know, this is not a black role, this is not an Asian role. Those kind of things are happening, not fast enough, in my opinion, but I just think about, you know, those portrayals are being seen by young people now, and what that could have changed for myself. So, Sean, I don't know if I answered. I wasn't holding this up. Oh my gosh. Sorry, Zoom good. People.
But I think we can continue talking about this a little bit with other discussants if they're interested, and then we'll move on to another slide there. Thank you so much, Angie.
Yeah, that was very, very insightful. I appreciate that. I really, really fascinated by that, and I wanted to kind of follow up on a couple of things that you mentioned. I was particularly interested. You have The King and I up there, which brings me to kind of the challenges as a theater educator in talking about shows that from the past, and in particular, when we talk about the performing arts, we are regularly reviving and adapting and bringing to life stories from the past again, and musicals and plays and music, etc. But when I think about The King and I also think about South Pacific, which is one of the more significant musicals, in my opinion, in the history of musical theater, and I talk about it quite a bit. Because it is the first musical that addressed the issue of racism. There is no specific antagonist in the musical South Pacific. There is solely the internal racism in several of the characters, which we are meant to root for throughout the story. But at the same time, when you look at South Pacific in today's lens, there are portrayals of Pacific Islanders that we would view as offensive, and there are aspects of that show that are deeply troubling and problematic. And so it is a show that you cannot present without having a nuanced discussion about it. It's not the sort of thing, and it is fascinating that, you know, just 15 years ago, it was revived on Broadway for the first time, and it was one of the most successful revivals of all time. And there was very little discussion about that aspect of South Pacific, the potential challenges and portrayals of different cultures. And so that inherently came to mind in talking about The King and I, obviously, which followed it, which is was also meant, intended to be a show that discussed bridging of cultural differences, and that's certainly the intention. And Oscar Hammerstein was very active and political and progressive in his time. But of course, as we look back on it, and we certainly look at Yul Brynner portraying that role and whatnot, that's problematic. And so, as an educator, we have to have those sorts of discussions with our students, and that's. And those are not always easy discussions to explain to a student that was born potentially after 9/11. There is a challenge in understanding how far we have come, But also, of course, there is a recognition of how far we still have to go. And I think that balance is important. You also mentioned Hamilton and representation. And Hamilton is a fantastic example of representation and has changed the game for musical theater. But at the same time, we can look at Hamilton 8 years later or 9 years later and say, oh, there are aspects of that story that are troubling. There are aspects of talking about a glorification of America without fully acknowledging that that there were challenges in the characters that are being portrayed that were not addressed or not actively addressed. And so art is fluid, there are changes, and we are learning. And it is not something where we can just all of a sudden say, okay, well now Hamilton is bad. No one should be promoting that. That would be counterproductive. That would be counterproductive to the thousands of artists of color in particular that it has empowered and allowed to work and continues to do so, and the good that it has caused. But we should still have those discussions in various settings and use art as a method of kind of bridging those potential gaps in terms of our cultural understanding.
Thank you,
Jeff. Yeah, of course.
If someone has one more brief comment, we can do that, and then we'll head into our next example there. Desirée, wonderful. Thank you.
Hi, everyone. If I put it in front of me, will that work? Just so that, okay. So I'm loving that this panel is talking about musicals so much. it's right up my alley. Yeah, points taken, I'll completely agree with all that has been said thus far. And I would just like to add, you know, sort of there's a reason why when you were growing up, you found Asians in musicals, right? Because musicals have been one of the film genres that most consistently features people of color, even if they're fake people of color, right? But there's a kind of cultural expression and a kind of cultural touchstone that musicals engage in, often problematically, especially in those earlier years. But it is, you know, sort of with the coming of sound to film in the late 20s, because of the way that sound technicians understood the human voice in that moment, black voices were especially desirable in that time. And so you had the first black cast, entirely black cast musicals being produced by the major Hollywood studios, Fox and MGM specifically in 1929. And so this gave, like you were saying, this incredible opportunity to people of color. Whereas they before, they had either been only featured perhaps as extras, they had been featured by white actors in blackface, or they were not there at all. And so now they had the opportunity to take the lead principal roles, and that was really important. So context, obviously, is always really important. You look at those 1929 musicals, and they are, you know, some of them are just, moments are just cringeworthy, but at the same time, really incredible performances by black performers who are giving it their best and hoping that this is going to be a moment that's going to change things. Changed a little bit, but not enough, as we all know. And so just kind of thinking about how the musical can be really multivalent in that way, or polysemic, I like to use that word, in the classroom, because it's a form of popular culture, because as the Hollywood studios produced it, it's made to make money, right? It's commerce as well as art, maybe more commerce than art. It has multiple dimensions, and we can't just read it in one way, and we certainly can't read it anachronistically from our perch in 2023 and say, well, that's bad, or the fact that they, you know, have somebody singing and dancing in blackface, that's bad, let's move on. Let's talk about why it's bad, but let's also talk about why it was happening in that moment and what it can tell us about 1929 and the structures of race that existed in that moment.
Thank you so much. We're going to move into a different area now, into the art realm there, and Professor Shea, Laura Shea, will talk to us a bit about her example here.
Sure, thank you. Excuse my voice. So I just wanted to bring in a painting on your left called Open Casket by Dana Schutz. This painting was exhibited at the 2017 Whitney Biennial, which is a really important group show every other year at the Whitney. And it's often a launching off point for artists and their careers. It also is known for sparking a lot of controversy. They seem to want to foster that a little bit. But in this case, this is a slightly abstracted painting of Emmett Till, who was murdered in 1955. And his body was brutalized. His mother insisted that he had an open casket funeral. And so she also insisted that photographs from that funeral be circulated by Jet Magazine, which was a magazine made by and for Black Americans. So when Dana Schutz, a white artist, presented this at the 2017 Whitney Biennial, there was a lot of backlash. Can you go back 1 second? So most notably, there were protesters that stood in front of the painting. His shirt reads Black Death Spectacle. So they just stood there and blocked it all day as a form of protest that the Whitney would not take it down. You can go to the next one. And so another artist, Hannah Black, who's English, not American, which I think is worth saying, wrote an open letter signed by many, many artists asking for the Whitney to take down the painting and to destroy it. It's a much longer letter, but I think the most important part here is that it's not acceptable for a white person to transmute Black suffering into profit and fun, though the practice has been normalized for a long time. The subject matter is not Schutz's. White free speech and white creative freedom have been founded on the constraint of others and are not natural rights. The painting must go. Could you go to the next slide? So these are some of the sorts of reactions. So Hannah Black was criticized by other artists like Coco Fusco, a Cuban-American artist who insisted that it's never, you're never on the right side of history when you're censoring things. Because Hannah Black did ask for it to be destroyed, that was an important part of her letter. And Coco Fusco calls it deeply puritanical and anti-intellectual. Christina Sharp, another very important scholar and professor in Black diaspora visual literature studies, she did sign on to the letter. And she said, I have her quote here, that Dana Schutz walked into this representation and this conflict and then this confrontation of representation. Schutz herself responded to the controversy by saying that she made the work of art from the perspective of a mother herself, realizing she's not a Black woman, but that she knows what it's, she doesn't know what it's like to lose a child, but she knows what it's like to love a child. So these are just some of the reactions. And I wanna say too, you know, I acknowledge that myself as a white woman, talking about the way that often a lot of white liberals responded to this is problematic too. I also, you know, recognize that this is part of my scholarship. I'm not trying to profit or have fun off of it per the last quote, but it is troubling and I am troubled by it and I'm kind of still working through that. But I also don't want to center myself. I just want to acknowledge that I am aware of that this is troubling. So I am just trying to present the reactions to it. So I think this brings up a lot of issues. One that we hear again and again with music and film and art, who can represent who? Who gets to make a movie about who? In what context? You know, is it enough that Schutz is a mother? Many people said, no, it's not enough that she's a mother. She doesn't understand this. It also brings up this idea of what do we do with these things that already exist? With these films that already exist, and what context can these be shown? There's also the issue of profit. Dana Schutz said she would never sell the painting. But I will say this contributed enormously to her career. She really went out of the picture for about 2 years, but now she's represented by one of the most major art galleries in the world. So she's certainly profiting off of this ultimately. So if any of my panelists have any thoughts on any of these issues, I would love to hear.
Thank you for that. I just wanted to say a little bit about this notion of profit. In one sense, profit may or may not be the motive for doing the work. We can't know that. On the other hand, it takes, and this is to the comment before about art is business, there's a message being put out through that art. And that message needs visibility. The way that messages get visibility is through organizations who can make money to provide that opportunity, to provide that platform for that visibility. So there is this tension of whether someone should make profit off of the work versus how do we expose the work? How do we expose the knowledge that comes from that work? How do we expose the real need to have conversations? Because if we do ban, and we've got a number of laws now, and we're in lots of discussions about banning books and banning art. If we ban, if we say that there's no way that we want to allow these platforms for this art and these conversations to take place, how in the world can we move forward? How in the world can we understand each other? How in the world can we understand, and this gets to the question of, is being a mother enough? We are not just one personality characteristic, to use Marilyn Lodin's term in her definition of diversity being about personality characteristics. We as individuals are not one personality characteristic. We're not just a mother. There's this notion of intersectionality. And if we start thinking of ourselves as just one personality dimension, as just another, then we have lost our humanity.
I just want to add one thing. Thank you for that. I think that clarified a lot of things. One, I'm forgetting their name, but one Black scholar of visual culture has described how paintings like this align the white artist, in this case Dana Schutz, with the oppressed rather than the oppressor. And so I think that's maybe a good way to think about it, because that allows for intersectionality of an individual while also thinking about larger structures in which this is made an issue, why it's ultimately an issue. But yeah, I certainly take your point of intersectionality. I think that was often lost in the debates around this discussion.
I didn't want to put people through the whole thing. It was a couple of clips.
It's the dance.
Yeah. No,
is like 2 minute clips.
Yes.
I mean, this is really good. Like, you know, we are one moment.
All right, so you're ready to dance? and my colleagues up here in the panel are saying, there's a lot there to unpack. And there certainly is. So the first comment I wanted to make is, and some of you who know me know I'm a philosophy major. And we philosophy majors love to start off with definitions. So we're talking about race. What is race? Race is a social construct with no basis in biological fact. So we have to start there as the context of which we're having this discussion in the first place. It's a social construct created by the dominant class, the dominant culture. The other topic I wanted to talk a little bit about in terms of definition is ethics. Second word in the title of this conversation, ethics. What is ethics? What are morals? Ethics for whom? We know that different cultures have different values and different ethical systems. So as we're having this discussion, we're all talking about ethics from our own individual perspectives. What I really liked about and why I chose this clip is that on a number of levels, and I really appreciate the comment about we examine art from multiple levels, multiple layers, right? And we need to appreciate art from multiple layers. This notion, first of all, that art, while it can be troubling, can also heal. And I think that's what Michael Jackson was trying to do with this video. He was trying to heal. He was trying to show that we are all in one. And the fact that he's, any other philosophy majors study Aristotle and the notion of the best arguments are made with ethos, pathos, and logos. This video has all three. And that's why it's so powerful. Art that has ethos, pathos, and logos is powerful, and we recognize it as such. Unconsciously, if not consciously. to Angie's discussion about not knowing, not having the right words, but having that feeling. So this video shows different cultures, and we didn't show the whole clip, but it has African dancers, it has Russian dancers, it has as all sorts as Indian dancers, showing them in a positive light. Not all art shows different cultures, and culture is actually an expression of ethnicity. Not all art shows people from different ethnicities and their cultures in a positive light. But this does, and it, that's part of what makes it, makes us feel good when we see it. Then the other thing I wanted to mention, because one of the questions here is we still need to reckon with the question, what do we do with great art by bad people? In recent years, Michael Jackson has been considered a bad person, but great art. So do we not play him? There are people who will not play Michael Jackson because he was a bad person. What are we missing by that? What are we missing by not playing him because he did something that was not quite good? What do we miss by not showing art by someone who was put into prison for some horrible crime? What are we missing? What are we losing in our humanity by not showing that art? So I just think it's so important for us to see art, be in the moment with that art. There is a need to contextualize the art, yes. But the art speaks to us as individuals because we are all unique. There's something in each piece of art that touches us because of our experiences. We need to allow that to reach us. And I'll stop there.
We can go to our next example. I mean, I think we can always refer back to this example there, because it, you know, 1991. Yes, we can refer back to this. So I'm going to continue on. We're setting up a few other questions here, but I think that, you know, as we already are discovering, our panelists are very much organically developing the questions and developing answers and thoughts that will carry us forward into this next set there. On artistic production, where does race fit? What are our barriers, and how should we deal with that? And so we have Matthew Morrison with our next example.
Not start with the clip, if that's okay.
That's fine.
Sorry. Thank you very much. All right. Can I put this here? If I don't have one hand to move, it's going to be a little problem for me. This is wonderful and rich and many things to think about. I'm glad to be able to sort of be quiet for a bit and sort of listen to and think about the things that you all are offering us. And I guess I want to start with this inquiry here on artistic production by thinking about the idea of how we conceive of and think through what art is in the first place, especially as my work is based primarily in the development of popular culture and music, right, and how in the 19th century in particular, that gets separated from what is considered to be, quote, high art or things connected to European American white culture versus popular culture, right, that is often connected to or grounded in people of color, especially in the context of music in the United States, which is birthed, right, out of blackface minstrelsy, the first original form of popular entertainment in the nation, which is also the foundational basis of much of what we're talking about here, because when we think about ideas of representation from an identitarian perspective, much of that is informed by how we come to imagine ourselves, other people and communities in relation to what develops in popular culture. So one thing I want to really sort of put a pin in is understanding that art, right, is a concept and a term that is fraught in many different ways. And so as we're talking about it today, I want to make clear that art, no matter how we are conceiving of it, whether it's classical, whether it's popular, or from any particular background or genre, is never created in a vacuum, right? It is never created in a vacuum. Even if you yourself live in a bubble, right? I want to refer back to the artwork that we were talking about here today from Rourke. It is still not created in a vacuum. So if one cares, right, about a certain level of human-to-human connectivity, if one cares about equity, if one cares about justice, if one cares about sort of not positioning or assuming one's own positionality as that in power in relation to others, then I think that sort of attending to what it means for really considering the political nature of creative work, whether it, again, is popular or whether it is considered to be something that is, you know, within the high art space, is significant. And especially kind of want to bring that back to our moment here at the, you know, as a college setting. I like to make sure to speak to and with students here. And I think I also want to take Professor Parr's provocation here about, you know, what does it mean in today's context, right, to think about these things. So for me as a historian, it is exceptionally important to really zero in on history and the archive, because truth is something at this moment, and facts at this moment, these are things that are right under great suspicion from various folks, right? And we want to make sure that if we're going to try to challenge and try to really set a foundation for what is a place that we can think of coming from equity and justice, that we have our histories and our facts right. And sometimes that means being uncomfortable in our own understandings individually of how we think about the function and the relation of art. I am very uncomfortable sitting here in front of a Michael Jackson clip because I myself don't play or listen to Michael at this point for personal pleasure, although I do still play Michael to teach, because as it is being discussed here by my esteemed colleague, these things don't disappear no matter whether we want them to or not. They're still part of what's functioning in our general cultural milieu, right? So what do we do with them is a question. And so that being said, to Sean's Parr's question, to Professor Parr's question around artistic production, where does race fit into our understanding of artistic production? What are our barriers to creating art, to making space for a more equitable, accessible, active artistic experience? And how do we deal with that, and why should we? So maybe now I'll play a bit of the clip, and then I'll wrap it up by giving a little bit of context for that clip. So this is the artist, Jake Blount. First, I want to actually extend a question to the audience. How would you describe or categorize this sound or genre? If I asked you right now and forced you to put this into a box or a genre, how might you describe the sound? And anyone, please feel free to shout out your thoughts.
Americana.
Americana.
Folk.
Folk. Any other, one, I mean, those are, right on target. World music, thank you. So Americana, folk, we'll start with those. when we think of Americana and folk, right, in terms of music and cultural production, what groups of people do you normally associate with those terms? And again, it's okay for us to just sort of like share what comes to mind. This is no judgment zone.
Protest singers.
Huh?
Protest singers.
Protest singers, that's a great point there. Absolutely, protest singers. Any other thoughts? Southerners, okay, yes. White European American, particularly. Do we often think of black people in relation to Americana and folk music? This, I'm asking a leading question here, right? Do we often think of queer people, right, in relation to Americana and folk music? So again, going back to this question of why is it that we get to a place where an artist like Jake Blount, who is an American, who claims the title of Americana, right, because it allows, in terms of how it's been subsumed or consumed by the music industry, even though it carries this idea of a certain type of nationhood, it still has not been sort of taken up commercially, specifically, as an expected sort of racialized white genre right away, right? And so you find a lot of black and queer artists who are actually performing country music, right? Mm-hmm. Who are performing string band music, who for various reasons commercially or culturally cannot break into the mainstream industry, find their way through this style, but they also found their way through this style by connecting to the historical development of black, of string band music, of country music, right, going all the way back to slavery, right, in which you have black Americans, Africans in America, with the banjo, with the fiddle, who are also interacting, right, with Irish and Scottish and English Americans, right, at various levels, but then creating and developing these string band styles that get taken up in blackface minstrelsy, come commercialized and racialized as white, but then become sort of developed as these racist tropes when placed onto black people, as a larger commercial industry continues to develop out of these racialized notions of what people are expected to be, to hear like, to hear, to look like, to sound like. Yellowface traditions come out of blackface, and also lock, right, one of the largest, you know, groups of ethnic peoples, right, into one category of Asian, right, which is impossible, okay, that then gets sort of locked into a very particular soundscape, right, that then gets rehearsed over and over and over so that we come to expect people to sound and look that way when we see them. This is hundreds of years in the making. These things are not disconnected from our politics or our everyday. And in order for us to really sort of unpack our personal, individual, and communal relationships to how art is made, created, and received, then I think it again requires a deep focus on the historical and sort of archival materials that allows us to really reveal how these things sort of develop over time.
Momentum as the microphone makes its way to me. Yeah, and I would add to genre, right? So trying to define what this kind of music is and how we associate certain genres with certain experiences, racialized groups in particular. Is my clip next or are we going to somebody else? Okay, so then it would be a good segue. One of the things that I've written about with the musical is the folk musical. And folk is a very, you know, we're talking about troubled art. Folk is a very troubled term as well. It's been used historically. Robin D.G. Kelly, if you're interested in this topic, has an excellent article on the way that the term folk has been racialized. And the folk musical emerges not in Hollywood, not by Hollywood filmmakers, but by filmmakers of color, ethnic filmmakers working outside of the Hollywood studios in the early 1930s. So I'm talking about black Americans, I'm talking about Jewish immigrants, and I'm talking about Mexican migrants who all use the musical in that moment to express what's important to their respective communities. Their respective communities that are on the move, that are migrating in great numbers, either to the north, from the south, to the southwest, from Mexico, to the east, from Eastern Europe. And these are musicals that very much, they weren't calling themselves folk, but they would come later to kind of define what the folk musical is, because they are primarily about that kind of burst into song kind of moment, right? Which we all associate with the musical now. But at the time, Hollywood studios were very much invested in sort of Broadway, adapting Broadway shows onto film. And so they would be stories about performers who put on a show, right? So 42nd Street, Broadway Melody, right. 1929. A lot of Al Jolson's early stuff is all about putting on a show, right? Because he's a performer, and he plays a performer in those films. But the ethnic musicals that are being made outside are about communities who are united in their experiences of being far from home, of adapting to a new place. Yes, it would eventually manifest as something like West Side Story or The Sound of Music. Those, sort of one of the key ways in which they communicated to the audience that they were part of a cohesive community was through song and dance. And those songs and dances would have been familiar to their audiences. Right, so that there was a kind of spectatorial response when you would go to watch these movies. You would know Ayano Rancho Grande, the Mexican folk song already. You would know a Yiddish folk song, and you would sing along with the screen, right? And this is something that Hollywood eventually took to and would manifest later in musicals we all are very familiar with, including the one that I want to show a clip from, which is 2016's La La Land. Mm. So as you watch it, and maybe just show 2 minutes, because we're short on time, but as you watch it, just think about yourself in the position of holding the camera and where you might be through the course of these 2 minutes with that camera. There is color, usually.
Okay, absolutely.
So, where are you with the camera in this? What did you notice about the way the camera is moving here, and consequently the cinematographer himself? Yeah, one of the dancers. You're very much embedded in this musical number, right? And this is a kind of classic burst into song musical number where there's no rhyme or reason, rationale for it, it just happens. This is sort of what I'm talking about with the folk musical, right? It's all about making community and making a sense of belonging, taking a series of separate individuals, here they're all in their cars, you know, stuck on in Los Angeles traffic, making them into a cohesive community, right? And showing that difference can be overcome, right, through song and dance. And the camera only emphasizes that by placing us inside that space. We are moving in between those cars with those dancers, feeling like another dancer, perhaps. The dancer, the camera's moving in a very dancer-like way. So, you know, I think that the folk is a really interesting sort of rhetorical device to use when thinking about the musical, because it's so much about the cultural expression of marginalized peoples, at least initially, and that language has been handed down formally in the way that we understand the musical. The very concept of bursting into song has those roots in those ethnic musicals. And so in that way, there's a real kind of sort of resilience and a kind of sort of power to that formal language that we see in these types of numbers. But at the same time, there's also this, you know, sort of, you can't get away from the more reductive element of the folk, right? Which Hollywood almost exclusively in its early days would showcase peoples of color singing, but only in all black cast films, right? Or, you know, if they might get a kind of solo spot in an otherwise white cast film. But they're always shown as being these, you know, this is using Eric Lott's phrase, musical creatures. Right? Peoples of color are these musical creatures who seemingly are able to sing and dance without any provocation. And they're all better singers and dancers than white Caucasians, right? And this doesn't just apply to black Americans. It's been, you know, similar to Latinos and Asians. Flower Drum Song is a kind of classic American musical that shows Chinese people to be, Chinese Americans to be, musical creatures. And so this is a kind of reductive element, right? That even with La La Land's kind of very multicultural opening and this kind of out of many one moment, that it's very, I think, very powerfully communicating at the start of this movie. And this is before we see any of the main characters. So this happens almost kind of outside of the narrative. And then we go, you know, very quickly to the two white principal characters who we follow for the rest of the film.
Right.
And, you know, sort of very controversially, if any of you remember the backlash against this film that happened in the wake of Donald Trump's election in 2016, suddenly liking this film was akin to being racist. I remember there was a tweet, because I was following this, because it's a moment when the musicals are in the news.
Right.
There was a tweet that said, I remember when liking musicals didn't make me racist. Right. So if you liked La La Land, then you were a racist and you were a Trump voter, right? That kind of has dissipated. When I teach this in classes today, students don't really know what I'm talking about. So I have to recreate the controversy. So 2016, two movies come out that are, you know, highly, highly critically lauded. La La Land, because it's the first original film musical to come out in years, right? Usually what Hollywood does, because it's safer with musicals, is to take what's already been successful on Broadway and just turn it into a movie. So, like, you know, Hairspray or something, Dreamgirls. But Damien Chazelle, the director, was able to create an original film musical, right? And it's this original story with original songs, original choreography, exclusively made for film. Never happens in Hollywood, not for decades. And it came out and it was a huge hit, both in the popular realm and critically. The other big movie is Barry Jenkins' Moonlight, another incredible film, right? That explores black Americans in Florida, but not just for talking about intersectionality, not just for the color of their skin, but also their sexuality, their class, their sort of larger socio-historical circumstances. It's an incredible movie. Donald Trump gets elected, and suddenly you had to choose one or the other. You can't like both, right? And one of the big problems with La La Land, and this was, is that one particular journalist focused on a later scene in the film when the two stars, Ryan Gosling and Emma Stone, are sitting in a jazz club listening to jazz being performed by black American performers. And Gosling is proceeding to explain, we would say now, mansplain to Emma Stone why jazz is important and what it is that they're doing, why it's so complex and why we should pay attention to it, right? So essentially translating blackness for the white character on screen and translating blackness for ostensibly the white audience in the theater. And this is absolutely a valid criticism of this film. I'm not trying to be apologetic for it, absolutely, right? Goes along with always casting white actors as the principal roles. But I would just say it's not it's by far the only, nor is it the worst example of cultural appropriation that happens in the musical or in American cinema more generally. So to focus exclusively on this film, I think, was very much a kind of flashpoint, you know, the kind of political moment we were in. Yeah. And because it was being pitted, you know, very, I think, unfairly against Moonlight, which is a radically different film. But, you know, to mention an earlier film like Hairspray, right? I don't know how many of you have seen that, 2007, where it's, you know, it's a white savior film where this, you know, young white girl who, because she has a body type that is different than what we consider to be beautiful, likens her circumstances with the segregated black kids in the movie, and managed to end desegregation all on her own through her own bravery. And no one said a word about that film when it came out. And that's the Obama era. And it's, you know, oh, isn't it so nice we can all hold hands and sing about how wonderful this is. So that's I guess that's my, you know, getting back to the issue of context, right? Let's look at the long view. Let's look at the history of how these things have been manifest over time. And why are they suddenly kind of flashpoints in one era when they weren't in another, but certainly should have been, right? We should have been talking about these issues all along, not just in 2016. Mm-hmm. So I'll leave it there.
Thank you. I think we'll have, Jesse has one comment there, and then we want to move right into Jaime's image there.
So. Absolutely. So yeah, this just this brought to mind when we were talking about kind of folk and the evolution of it. It just kind of I started jotting down this one specific instance in which we see African Americans in particular try to reclaim aspects of their culture that's being taken from them, or and so. But in terms of, I kind of tracked this out, you have Uncle Tom's Cabin written in the 1850s, which creates the Uncle Tom narrative that ends up being in minstrelsy, which, as Matthew said, is kind of the first American popular art form, which is, you know, speaks volumes in and of itself. But from minstrelsy, we go into vaudeville. And in the vaudeville era, you have Burt Williams, who is an African American, who says, I see them doing this portrayal. I can do it better than white people can do. And himself, as an African American, becomes famous and tours throughout the country as in blackface, performing in blackface.
As a Caribbean American who was imitating these ideas of what black American stereotypes were.
Exactly, thank you. Yes, and then out of that you have Al Jolson's Mammy coming directly from that. And to contrast that, to push back on that, you have Paul Robeson, we're talking about Oscar Hammerstein earlier, of Rodgers and Hammerstein, writing Showboat. You have Paul Robeson singing Old Man River, a song that is written for him in this show that is exclusively about white people, but they give this one song to a black artist that is, and then we focus on the white protagonist for the remainder of that show. Old Man River turns into Disney's Uncle Remus in Song of the South. And then you have black artists in the 60s trying again to reclaim this with A Change Is Gonna Come, using some of the language directly from Old Man River. So just kind of tracking that struggle again back and forth is, I think, an interesting context on how art and music, especially in terms of African-American influence in the United States, has kind of ebbed and flowed, and there has been a constant attempt to reclaim it and to take it back from what is largely been a white-dominated popular culture.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, everyone. And when we had our first meeting, I have no idea what I was invited, because I don't dance. I might be the only Colombian who doesn't dance. That's what my wife says. But anyway, so. But then as Sean talked a little bit, everything is kind of connected. So I'm going to focus on Colombia. And in Colombia, and this is a very controversial topic, but my personal opinion is that race is not given by your skin color. Is more for the political power that you have or the economical power that you have. So you call yourself white if you have power, or people call you black if you don't have power or either political or economical. So easy to move on your skin color. And as you may know, Colombia has had a lot of problem with drugs. So that was the easiest way to move up in, again, it's my personal opinion, so in your skin color. So that's why, and I'm gonna come back to this in a little bit, but that's why it was easier to change your skin color through easy money. So Colombia is not a country of immigrants. It's only for the last 25 years that we have received a lot of people from Venezuela, but Colombia is an immigrant country within. So people from the countryside move to the big cities. Mm-hmm. In the past, used to be because the big cities have more industries, and in the last 70 years, like in this picture, is because they were escaping violence. Because since drugs became so popular, and they stopped growing different types of products, and they have to grow cocaine. And I say they have to, because if they didn't do it, they got killed. And that's why they moved to the countryside. And I'm telling you all of this because I'm here not by choice, and it's not that Sean made me do this. It's because I didn't want to have to do anything with this. I grew up with this, so I'm an engineer. I have nothing to do with literature. So I moved to the US because I wanted to get a master's degree in engineering. And I made one mistake. I took one literature class, and then I fell in love with literature. but so I started reading literature, and I say, I don't want to deal with this. I don't want to read anything that it has to do with race, violence. So I started reading science fiction and fantastic literature. Another big mistake. They were talking about the same thing, but in a different universe, in a different, in the future or in your dreams. So I couldn't escape this. Yeah. So and the first short story that I wrote was one of the most violent moments that I had in my life when two of my cousins died, and I didn't want to do that. So that's what I said, that I'm here not by choice. So I was debating when I started writing, like, I don't want to write about sad stuff. I'm gonna let Netflix with Narcos tell the story about how much we suffer. So they're giving us the perspective of this cool guy, Pablo Escobar, who got everything he wanted, but we are not worried about the victims. We are not worried about the people who suffer through that. That is pretty much a lot of people in Colombia. Like, I could tell you my story, and if you go to Colombia, I'm just one more of that suffer, people, relatives who were kidnapped, people who died in bombs. I'm just one more of many. And the way that I relate this with race is because they were trying to move up in the race. Okay. And that was what I had. So I'm sorry.
Thank you. Do we have one comment there? And I think we're going to move into our Q&A section there of the panel there. But any comment right now?
Just one more. Thanks. So just to highlight that race and the dominant culture is different in different countries and different cultures. So as we're here talking mostly about how it impacts us in the United States, we do need to be cognizant that in other places, the dominant culture is different. Think about Africa. Who's the dominant culture there? And there is some really interesting dynamics when you talk about Africa and who's in control of the government and who decides what, how race is defined and when you have to define yourself as one race or another.
All right. In the interest of time, I think we're going to open up to our Q&A right now there, and I think many of these strands can be connected there as we hear from you all and some questions you may have or some comments you may have to add to our discussion there. Do we have anyone who'd like to open up there? Yes, please. A question about Emmett Till's mother, who put out the photos, the images, purposely so. And we might have a comment here from our panel.
Yeah,
Yeah, so I think you're absolutely right. Emmett Till's mother set the stage for the viewing to be public. So if anyone were to say, no, we don't want to have that shown, that's going against the wishes of the mother made public already, right? And with my NAACP hat on, Emmett Till's mother had conversations with the NAACP as to how to approach this.
Absolutely, yeah.
And the joint decision was made to have it be public. So.
And it was Emmett Till's mother. It was her son.
Yeah. Right.
I'll also maybe add here, I don't want to sort of assume what Laura's pointing to here, but I think some of the things that she's noting around this controversy in that particular work as well is that, again, these things are not being created in a vacuum. And you brought in the idea of intersectionality, right? And so if one is wanting to make, you know, art, you know, that provokes, that gets people to think, that moves the needle, you know, that shocks and all these things, then one fully has the right to do that. Just like with one has freedom of speech. It does not mean that it comes without potential consequences, because it still is happening in relation to other people who exist, right? So I'll just say that there are many angles that could have been taken in relation to the Emmett Till case, right, that did not have to do with rehearsing the violence of circulating, right, those images. So this particular image really sort of became the outside of lynching postcards, which were circulated for decades, right, as a source of fun, right, for primarily white consumers, right, whether they would go to lynchings and watch these violent, heinous acts, right, in real time with families and picnics, and then trade postcards about these things and listen to recordings that were sort of feigned around them, right? There are histories of the sort of circulating, images of Black death, right? And these images also conjure up many responses that then also lead in unfortunate ways, right, to some sense of profit, right? And that has been happening since slavery. So social media, right, gains great traction, you know, in Black Lives Matter by circulating images. Rodney King, right, becomes another instance early on in the 90s of what happens with the sort of presentation of the violence experienced by Black Americans day to day in a quotidian sense that becomes then spectacular. But I'll say this to say, by the time that this artwork was made, it was clear that the white woman who accused Emmett Till as a child of whistling at her had lied. She had admitted to lying. So there were, again, many angles that the artist could have taken that could have put her in direct conversation, right, with other sides of the story, rather than drawing directly on the sort of tragedy of Emmett Till and his mother to align herself with that side of it. So there, you know, so again, she can do whatever she wants to, but it still does not come without consequence or question. Hmm. Sure. Yeah. That's a great question. Thank you for that. Black people can be capitalists too. That's kind of the simple answer to that question, right? So it is important, right, for us. So I think this gets back to some of the themes here, that representation is so important in the context of the United States, because again, how many people have been written out of certain histories, right? But representation is really only the first step in getting towards some sense of equity and justice, right? And so I'll actually just reference my students here back at NYU in the Tisch School at Clive Davis, who are currently, we're organizing a community event with the full staff and faculty and student community, where we're talking about issues of ethics and equity and justice in the music industry proper. And one of the things that the students themselves came up with is, like, you know, if you look at the Spotify charts, and if you look at Apple Music, and if you look at these various charts, right, to sort of say what's popular, it will look like, you know, there are women here, there are people of color here, you know, we're doing pretty good. But then they have another slide, right? That's the gotcha, of course, which I was like, that's a good job. This is how we do this. But which was, who were the producers, right? Who were the engineers? Who were the executives? Who was the legal team? And it all still, majority, right, is white male run, right? And so again, this goes back to this idea of representation, who is largely controlling the narrative. So yes, Jay-Z exists. Yes, there are more black producers, writers, and songwriters, right, than ever before. There are more women, there are more queer folk. More still does not equal a critical mass, right? And those things, those people who are part of it, right, I don't know, it depends on their politics. Because if their politics are about further exploitation and capital gain, then we are not on the same side, even if we happen to be part of the same racial demographic.
Thank you. We have one time for one more question. Yes, please.
So,
no, you go ahead.
I think it says that this is complex to start with, and I think it's this. It's a manifestation of the struggle we have of who should solve this problem. Is it white people? Is it black people? And where are we in this journey to solving the problem, right? And you know, when some of you know, when I do workshops on diversity, equity, and inclusion, and I love your point about we're starting to get more representation, but it's not being equitably included, right? One of the conversational norms that I like to put forth is expect and accept non-closure. It has taken us hundreds of years to get to the point of where we are. Thousands of years to get to the point of where we are with how races are defined and treated. We can't expect that it's going to change overnight or next month or next year. So I'm encouraged that we're seeing progress in the representation piece. We do need to start talking more about the equitable inclusion piece. And to your question about we're making excuses for one race versus the other, we are seeing that. But we're still grappling with not being able to come together to create the solution. We're still pointing fingers. We're still saying, well, this white person can say this, and we aren't saying that the black people can say that. Until we start saying that we all should be having the discussions and supporting and calling in all races, we're going to continue to not make the progress that we need to make. So I think you're right. We haven't got to the point where we're treating each race equitably.
Even when they need to be called out.
Even when they need to be called out or called. I like to use a calling in, because calling out gets people's defenses up, right? We want to call people in, invite them into a positive experience and a positive way to move forward.
Yeah.
That's wonderful. Thank you all so much. I want to give the panel a big round of applause there. Thank you all very much. Thank you. It's been a wonderful discussion. I'm very grateful to you all for being here. Please, if you'd like to stay and chat with us, we're happy to, and looking forward to continuing discussions in the future. Thank you so much for coming.
Thank you to Sean.